Let me say good evening and happy Sabbath to everyone. I'm very thankful to be with you all this evening and to once again have an opportunity to share the Word of God with God's people. And as you can see tonight, I wanted to be as much in harmony with God's people here in the Philippines. And I'm very grateful for the gift that the ministry has given as it relates to the barong that I'm wearing. And I feel more like a Filipino. And it's a privilege to study the Word of God with you this evening. And I just pray that all of our hearts are prepared to hear from the Lord. So at this time, as much as we are able to, let's go before the Lord and let us kneel for a word of prayer together. Our Father in heaven, we thank you, Lord, for the blessings of bringing us all safely through another week. We thank you for your tender care and your mercy that has been with us. We thank you for the fresh revelations of Jesus and his truth that we have received all throughout this week and that has truly ministered to our hearts. And so it is tonight, as you prepare us to understand the first work of reformation, I pray that your Spirit will be with us in a special way, that you'll first forgive us of our sins, and that you'll cleanse us from all unrighteousness, and that you would grant us the presence of your Spirit, that he may come and teach us and open our eyes and help us to behold wondrous things out of your law. And I just thank you, dear God, that you've heard this prayer, and I trust that you have answered it, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I would like to invite you to turn your Bibles to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 10 with me. We're going to the book of 1 Corinthians, and we're going to look at the 10th chapter, and we're going to let the Word of God speak to us. We reviewed this chapter yesterday, but you're going to see there's a great relevance in reviewing the chapter again. 1 Corinthians, the 10th chapter. And when you get there, please let me know by saying amen. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 10, and we're going to look again at verse 11. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 10 and verse 11, after the Bible has already shown us that the children of Israel has left Egypt and they are now on their way to Canaan land, we know that they fell into many great sins between verses 5 to 10. But in verse 11, the Bible says, now all these things happen unto them. Who's the them? That's Israel. It says, now all these things happen unto them for ensamples. And the word ensamples means types. Very good. And every type must have an anti-type. So therefore, the Bible says, now all these things happen unto them, and they are written for whose admonition? It says, and it is written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the world are come. Now, when Paul said our admonition, is he referring to unbelievers or believers? He's referring to believers. But notice that he says our admonition, upon whom the what? Ends of the world are come. So is that talking about early day believers or last day believers? It's talking about the last day believers. So therefore, when we look at 1 Corinthians 10:11, it is showing us that according to the Bible, when the children of Israel left Egypt on their way to Canaan land, it was a type of what God's people who leave the Egypt of the world and sin will go through similar experiences as we're heading to heavenly Canaan. And therefore, when we study the Old Testament and when we look at the children of Israel and watch their journeys, we very much are studying our own lives. We're studying our own experiences. And so it is that when we look at the children of Israel, you'll remember that when they were in bondage, under Pharaoh and Egypt, you'll remember that God had to reveal his wonders to them. Do you remember when the Bible said that? When God literally told Moses, he says, I'm going to use you and that rod. And he says, and I'm going to display my wonders to Israel. And so he did. And you know that Moses did all sorts of wonderful miracles and great things and many blessings that was revealed to Israel that gave them hope. In other words, when God revealed his wonders through his servant Moses and Aaron, it brought about a revival amongst Israel. And as Israel was revived, ultimately they were delivered from their captivity. And so we find that when you get to the book of Exodus, the 16th chapter, it now gives us a picture of the first work of reformation that God brought to Israel after the revival. Now, all this week, we've been studying about the things that can bring about a revival in our heart. We talked about the importance of prayer. We talked about the importance of the ministry of the Holy Spirit. We talked about the importance of personal Bible study and seeing Jesus as the central theme of everything that we read. We also studied and saw that it is imperative that we must share God's truth with others. We saw that God has even given us a program called Outpost Centers and how it's the modern day school of the prophets. And all of these things God gave to us as a means of bringing about a true revival in our hearts. But brothers and sisters, every revival ultimately must lead to a reformation. The only true revivals that people experience will be demonstrated in how their lives are reformed. So therefore, the question is, what's the first work of reformation? And the best way to answer that is to study the type. When you look at Israel, they beheld the wonders of God. They saw the goodness of God. They were exposed to the word of God, the power of his spirit, and the movement of his grace. And it was all of that that brought a tremendous revival in the hearts of Israel. But ultimately, God knew, now that you are revived, now that you are delivered from the bondage of Egypt, now it is time for a reformation. And the question is, what was the first work of reformation that God gave to Israel? Go to the book of Exodus, the 16th chapter. In Exodus, the 16th chapter, this is directly after the children of Israel have left Egypt. They are now a delivered people. And as a result of this, God knows that there's going to be a need for a re-education. You see, once an individual comes out of darkness and enter into God's marvelous light, there's a need for education now. There's a need for serious instruction. And so it is that you find in the book of Exodus, the 16th chapter, God wants to prepare Israel for the instruction. We know that the great instruction that God wanted to give Israel was his holy law, the Ten Commandments. He wanted to refresh their minds on his principles of truth, the Decalogue, the Ten Commandments. But here it is that prior to that, God saw, well, there's a work of reform that I need to do first that is going to prepare them for Sinai. And notice what the Bible says in Exodus, the 16th chapter, and we're now going to go ahead and look at verses 1 through 4. The Bible says in Exodus 16, verses 1 through 4, it says, "And they took their journey from Elim, and all the congregation of the children of Israel came unto the wilderness of Sin, which is between Elim and Sinai, on the 15th day of the second month after their departing out of the land of Egypt. And the whole congregation of the children of Israel murmured against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. And the children of Israel said unto them, Would to God we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the what? Flesh pots. And when we did eat bread to the full, for ye have brought us forth into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger." Israel, can you imagine? It was not even but so long after the children of Israel were delivered by the mighty hand of God. And as soon as their God bellies growled, they forgot about the God who delivered them. And now they're already complaining. And here it is that God, in compassion, I tell you the truth, we serve a merciful, patient Savior. Because God had every right to say, you know what, go back to Egypt then. God could have said, oh, so I guess I delivered you by accident. Well, let me put you back in bondage. So since you're reflecting on Egypt. But God is too loving to do things like that to us saints. We need to praise God for his tender mercies to us. God in mercy hears their cry. And notice what God does in verse 4. The Bible says in verse 4, "Then said the Lord unto Moses, Behold, I will rain bread from heaven for you. And the people shall go out and gather a certain rate every day, that I may prove them whether they will walk in my law or no." The first work of reformation that God brought to Israel was on the point of appetite. That was the first work of reformation. Immediately after they were brought out of their bondage, God says, change their diet. Now, brothers and sisters, you have to understand, God knew what he was doing, but many a times I wonder if we understand what the Lord was doing. You see, every revival must lead to a reformation. You remember that when Jesus saw the woman who committed adultery, and all those Pharisees wanted her to be killed, here it is that Jesus in mercy forgave her for her sins. But you remember what Jesus said. Jesus said to the woman, has any man condemned you? She says, no, my Lord. He says, well, neither do I condemn you. But then he said, go and sin no more. Jesus meets a man at the pool of Bethesda in John chapter 5. When he meets the man at the pool of Bethesda in John 5, he's been sick for 38 years. Jesus comes to him and asks him a question. Do you want to get well? Here it is, the brother says, well, I want to get well, but, and he starts going through all his excuses. Jesus bypasses his excuses, and then Jesus says, get up, take up your mat, and start walking. He acts on the word of God by faith, and he is healed. Praise the Lord. Verse 14 of John 5, Jesus sees him again, and Jesus says, good, you're well, sin no more, lest a worse thing come upon you. Jesus, in his ministry, always believed in the combining of revival and reformation. Jesus never just wanted to just revive people, but then say, go back and keep doing what you're doing. Jesus never did that kind of work, and Seventh-day Adventists shouldn't do that kind of work. Our ministry and our mission to the world is to let them know what sin is, to let them know that it has separated them between themselves and their God. And then we are to present Jesus, the Lamb of God, that unites them. And then we are to tell them, go and sin no more. Now, Israel was in bondage. There were several reasons that they went into bondage. But God now delivered them, and God knew, I want to change you, Israel. I want to put you in a position where you never have to go back into Egypt, yea, bondage again. And therefore, God says, the first work of reformation that I'm going to do with you is I need to change your diet. And the same way that we are God's Israel today, what do you think is the first work of reformation that we should experience? Change of diet. This is why it was under the inspiration of Jesus Christ that Ellen White says that in order to make the temperance movement a success, the work of reform must begin at our tables. That's the first work of reformation, practically, is that it must begin at our tables. That's the first work of reform. Why? Because it was the first work of reform with God. Ellen White was just following the pattern. She was looking at the type showed it. That's the first work of reformation that God did with Israel. And the question is, why is it that the first work of reformation takes place with diet? Why is it that God takes diet so seriously? Why is it that Brother Rizzo is going all throughout this week patiently and eloquently and intelligently laboring with God's people and showing the imperative importance of guarding the appetite? Why? You see, brothers and sisters, it's so much deeper than just simply having good lungs, good kidneys, and strong hearts. Having a good lung, having good kidneys, having a strong heart are all fringe benefits of health. Do you know that the chief reason for health reform, do you really want to know what the reason for health reform really is? Brothers and sisters, do you know the real purpose of health reform? Health reform is more about holiness than about health. I want to say that one more time. The work and message of health reform is more about holiness than about just simply having good, strong, healthy bodies. How do we know that? Well, I'm going to give you both Bible and spirit of prophecy tonight. The first thing I want you to do is I want you to turn your Bibles to the book of Proverbs, the 30th chapter. In Proverbs, the 30th chapter, I want you to see something here. You see, boy, this is going to be a sweet study tonight. We're going to look at the Word of God. We're going to look at that Word of God like we never looked at it before. In Proverbs, the 30th chapter, Solomon, the wise man, I want you to see something that he says here, which is so powerful, and I want you to really grasp it, because the Bible shows that there was something that Solomon understood, David understood, and so on. In fact, go to Psalm 139 first, and then we'll go to Proverbs 30. Just for a little more context. I like context. Go to Psalm 139. And then we're going to go to Proverbs 30. In Psalm 139, notice this, because this is Solomon's daddy talking here. In Psalms, the 139th division now, I want you to see what the Bible says. And if you're there, please let me know by saying amen. Now, the Bible says in Psalm 139 and verse 14, I want you to think with me on this, because sometimes we can't just simply understand what a person says. We need to get the idea behind why they said it. The Bible says in Psalms, the 139th division in verse 14, and if you're there, please say amen. David says, I will praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well. Of course, he begins to go into his very being. My substance was hid in thee. And he goes on. David understood something about human physiology to the point that he said, I am marveling at how fearfully and wonderfully you have made this creation. The children of Israel were taught to understand physiology. It was the basis of every line of education. And I'm going to show you that in just a moment. That's why David was able, he wasn't just making an abstract, empty statement. David understood the body. And he understood the God who made the body. And it was through this heavenly combination that David was able to say, I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works. Now, David, being though he messed up in many respects as a father, we know that David did much good. Amen. And David imparted this knowledge unto his son, Solomon. And therefore, Solomon now demonstrates his understanding of physiology as we now review Proverbs chapter 30. Now go to Proverbs, the 30th chapter. And I want you to see this. Proverbs, the 30th chapter. Solomon begins to express something here. And Solomon has every right to say this because he understood failure. Solomon has been through a lot. He has made all sorts of wicked, horrible decisions. And now Solomon is at the point where he is about to make a comment here in Proverbs 30. And we're going to consider verse 7. And I want you to see what the Bible says here. In Proverbs chapter 30 and verse 7, the Bible says, two things have I required of thee. Deny me them not before I die. Remove far from me vanity and lies. Give me neither poverty nor riches. Now watch the next statement he says here. Feed me with food, what? Convenient for me. Now, brothers and sisters, you know what I like about this? Solomon is actually giving an inspired guideline to eating habits. He says, feed me with food, what? Convenient. Now watch the contrast to convenient in verse 9. He says, feed me with food convenient for me, verse 9, lest I be what? Full. So question, is convenient and full synonymous? Huh? Is convenient and full synonymous? No, they are not. They're in contrast one to another. He says, I want you to feed me with enough food that is convenient or sufficient for me, or else I'll be what? Full. And what happens if you eat till you're full? It says, lest I be full and deny thee and say, who is the Lord? If you study the Bible carefully, brothers and sisters, you will find that often when the Bible says eating to the full, it is negative. It is sinful. Uh-oh, somebody said sinful. You know, I noticed something out here in the precious island of the Philippines. I realized that diet is a very sensitive thing for our people here. And there are several reasons for that. And one of the things that individuals are especially sensitive with is talk about the good and bad of food, but don't make it affect our salvation. Once you touch that and say, wait a minute, are you saying that my habits of eating and drinking can affect my salvation? All of a sudden, everybody gets up and caught up into a fluster, and they say, you're abusing the word of God. Now, brothers and sisters, I don't believe it's an abuse of the word of God. I believe it's the straight word of God. I understand that we definitely can become fanatical with the Bible as it relates to diet. There is a chapter in the book Counsels on Diets and Foods that all of us would do well to study, and that chapter is called Extremes in Diet. It is possible to be extreme on the point of diet, but brothers and sisters, there's a time that an individual's not being extreme, they're just being straight. And I want you to see the straight testimony from the Word of God as it relates to this subject called appetite. Go to the book of Isaiah 59. Watch this with me. Can my eating and drinking habits honestly affect my salvation? Can that happen? Because too often we try to make it sound, because I'm going to be honest with you, there's something that I have the privilege of understanding. Something that I have the privilege of understanding. I even saw it demonstrated this week in just communing with brethren. When you tell people that something is wrong, when the argument is agitated long enough, you know what's the funny thing? It makes me laugh in my heart, even though I can't laugh in people's faces. That would be rude. But it makes me laugh in my heart. You know what I found? Whenever a man or a woman has an idol in their life, and when you begin to show them from inspiration that that idol that you're living by or practicing or doing is wrong, and when we start going back and forth, guess what's the magic question that always comes up? It's 100% of the time it always comes up. Guess what the argument is? What does this have to do with my salvation? Brothers and sisters, I don't care what the subject is. When God's people come together and they start going back and forth, and back and forth over an issue, you know what's the bottom line of the discussion? Sooner or later, it always comes up. You know what people say? Listen, are you saying that I'll be lost if I do this? And do you know what the psychology is? Once you say, oh no, I'm not saying this affects your salvation, you know what they do? Whoop, and they shut you down. And they say, then I don't care what you say anymore at this point. And this is why, if something can affect someone's salvation, it is the minister of the gospel's job to point it out. Because he understands the mind of the people. It is in the book, volume 4 of the Testimonies to the Church, page 67. That's for those of you taking notes who really want to be students of the Word of God. When you read volume 4 of the Testimonies to the Church, page 67, Ellen White says that when doing the work of evangelism, we must understand the human mind and human nature. And she says, when we understand it, where we only won one soul to Christ, we could have won 20. And so you'll find that the more that we understand the human mind and the way people think, that's why I'm very deliberate with the ministry God has given to me. If God says it affects our salvation, I'm going to say it straight. Why? Because I know the majority of the mindset of the people is, well, okay, eating this is bad, yeah. Eating that, yeah, maybe my kidneys, maybe my heart, yeah. But you know what? Does it affect my salvation? No, it doesn't affect your salvation. Okay, thanks, but no thanks. And then they literally move on. But I found that many a times when you give people the honest truth and say, hey, did you know that this can literally affect your salvation? This is not just a bad habit, this is sinful. Once an individual who loves Jesus understands that, they begin to take that counsel a lot more seriously. And I believe it is the minister of the gospel's job to bring those points out as well. And therefore, you're in Isaiah 59. And the Bible says in Isaiah 59, it says, but your what? Iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have caused him to turn his face from you that he will not hear. So according to the Bible, what is the effect of iniquity? It separates us from God. When a man is separated from God, is his salvation in jeopardy? Yes. So therefore, according to the Bible, if someone practices iniquity, it affects their salvation. Can you say that is true? Now watch this. So we are in agreement that iniquity can affect someone's salvation. Now let's let the Bible tell us what is iniquity. Go to the book of Ezekiel 16. Watch this one now. Ezekiel, the 16th chapter. In Ezekiel, the 16th chapter, notice what the Bible says. And this, When you understand this, this is why Solomon, this is why David, this is why Daniel, praise God, this is why Jesus took appetite so seriously, and this is why you and I need to take it seriously. The Bible says in Ezekiel, the 16th chapter, and I want you to look carefully now at verse 49. And in Ezekiel chapter 16 and verse 49, let's notice what the Bible says. The Bible says in Ezekiel 16, 49, behold, this was the what? Iniquity of who? Thy sister Sodom. Now watch this. Ezekiel is about to explain to God's people what iniquity is based on the practices of Sodom. What's the first thing on the list? Pride. So according to the Bible, is being proud iniquity? Can iniquity affect your salvation? Yes. Now what's the next thing on the list? Fullness of bread. Question, what is that? Fullness of bread is what? Gluttony. Another way of saying gluttony is overeating. Is overeating an eating and drinking habit? According to the Bible, is overeating iniquity? Can iniquity affect your salvation? So should God's people overeat? No, God never wanted us, and this is why, and I perfectly understand, I just think it's wordplay. What God wants for us to do, and I know that we're in harmony here, is that God does not want us to eat until we're full. God wants us to eat until we're satisfied. When you study the Bible, when individuals eat until they can't eat anymore, that is overeating. When you feel like your belly is about to bust, as Dr. Rizzo said very clearly, when you and I eat, there comes a point in time that your brain literally sends a message and says, you've had enough. You can stop now. And when we ignore that message and we say, no, I'm going to clean my plate, and we begin to eat anyhow, brothers and sisters, it begins to have a very adverse effect on us. And I want you to see this. Watch this now. We're going to take a look at some things. You see, we know that the work of reform must begin at our tables. Now, when God gave us diet in the beginning of time, notice what he did. God gave us the original diet. The original diet was found in Genesis 1:29, we know, when it says, and God said, behold, I've given you every herb-bearing seed which is upon the face of all the earth, and every tree in the which is the fruit of a tree yielding seed, to you it shall be for meat. So the original diet that God gave to man, which by the way was very good, it was fruits, grains, and nuts. Now please understand, saints, that whenever you study the creation account in the book of Genesis, when the Bible says, and it was good, the Bible say, and the evening and the morning was the second day, and it was good. The evening and the morning was the fourth day, and it was good. Whenever the Bible uses that word good, it's a Hebrew word called tov, T-O-W-B. And you know what the word means? Beneficial. So when God made the sunlight, God said it was beneficial. When God made the open air on day two, it was beneficial. When God gave the plant-based diet to mankind, God did not just simply say it was a good idea. God said it was the best beneficial diet to mankind. You know, I like referencing science when I do presentations, but I want to make it clear that science is late. God knew this all along, and God gave it to us a long time ago. And people gloat over the fact that today we have little videos like, fat, sick, and nearly dead. And then, of course, the other video, the one that's really big with Rick Esselstein and T. Colin Campbell, forks over knives, and all these things. Brothers and sisters, God gave us forks over knives over 100 years ago. It was called Councils on Diets and Foods. It was called Councils on Health. It was called medical ministry. God gave us these things a long time ago. The problem is that we've been sitting on our health message, and now the world is ahead of us. And now we got to reference them to help them see what God was saying all along. That's sad. Now, in the beginning, God gave fruits, grains, and nuts, but it was after sin that God says, now thou shalt eat the herbs of the field. Genesis 3:18. It was after sin that God added the vegetable kingdom also to the diet. So therefore, it was a full plant-based plan where God gave fruits, grains, nuts, and vegetables. And God gave this to mankind because he knew that this was going to be the most beneficial thing for mankind. Now, after this, saints, you will remember that when God made man out of the dust of the ground, look at it, Genesis 2:7. And the Lord God formed man out of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a what? The Bible says man became a living soul. Now man came out of the dust of the ground. And that's why it is interesting, because what's in the dust of the ground are all the elements that mankind needs to survive today. Notice, from the elements to man, all the elements from the dust is found in man. Magnesium, phosphorus, calcium, potassium, sodium, iron, iodine, chlorine, sulfur, etc. Therefore, we should choose foods that come from a root system. It was logical when God made man out of the dust of the ground. God knew, well, obviously, I want to go ahead and sustain man. So therefore, he's going to need the things that come from the ground to sustain him day by day. All those nutrients that we've been hearing about all week. Now, watch this. Do you believe that this is true, that all these elements right here, they come from the soil? Do you believe that? Do you also believe that all we need is to get these nutrients into our system for our sustenance? Yes? Now, here's my question to you. If all of these nutrients are already in the soil, why is it that we spend so much money on tofu? Do you know how much money you remember we talked about outpost centers last night? Do you know you can get an outpost center started in another week if all we did was eat bowls of dirt every day and took all that money we buy tofu with and put it towards the work? So why don't we all just start eating a bowl of dirt? Dirt for everybody. Is that a good idea? Is that a good idea? Why isn't it a good idea? You just said that all the nutrients that we need is in the soil. So why in the world can't we just go ahead and eat some big bowls of dirt so everybody can just be happy, save money, and finish the work? Why can't we do that? You know why we can't do that? Because, yes, it is true that these elements are in the soil. But it is also true that the soil is in what's called an inorganic state. Which means that though the nutrients are in there, if we were to take it in its raw state like that, it's inorganic and it would not benefit the body. So therefore, if you all ate bowls of dirt every day, it won't be long before you would end up dropping dead and die of malnutrition. Now watch this. This is why the soil has to come in contact with a root system. Because when the inorganic soil comes in contact with the root system, the soil, the nutrients in the soil, goes through a conversion process. And then it goes from inorganic to organic. And then it's able to bear fruit, and then we can eat that fruit and it can benefit the body. Do you understand? I don't think you understand. Let's try it one more time. The reason we cannot eat bowls of dirt, saints, because I don't want anybody here leaving and eating bowls of dirt and then talk about Brother Lemon said eat bowls of dirt and then y'all drop dead and get sick and now the conference is going to come after me. I'm telling you right now, I am not telling you to eat bowls of dirt. I'm reasoning with you. Listen to what I'm saying. What I'm saying is that it is true the nutrients we need is in the soil. But the problem is that the soil is in a what kind of state? Inorganic state. Can inorganic materials benefit our body? No. So therefore, we need the inorganic state to become what? Organic. So in order for that to happen, it must come in contact with a root system. So the soil has to come in contact with a root system. When it comes in contact with a root system, the soil gets what? Converted. And then it goes from inorganic to organic. And then it's able to bear fruit, and then we can eat the fruit and it can benefit the body. Did you get it now?
Yes.
You still didn't get it. You know why I don't believe you got it? Because your mind is too stuck on the natural. One day Jesus was walking amongst the Pharisees in Matthew 13, and he gave a parable of the sower. When Jesus gave the parable of the sower, he compared the human heart to soil. And when Jesus compared the human heart to soil, do you know that our hearts in its natural state is inorganic and cannot benefit the body of Christ? Yes? Yes? If you don't believe me, you just read Jeremiah 17:9. It says the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Your heart cannot benefit the body of Christ naturally. So therefore, watch this. The soil of our heart must come in contact with the root and offspring of David. That's Jesus. Revelation 22:16. When our hearts come in contact with the root and offspring of David, guess what our hearts go through? A conversion process. And our hearts go from an inorganic state to an organic state where now we can bear the fruit of the Spirit. And when we can bear the fruit of the Spirit, we can benefit the body of Christ. Do you get it now? No wonder Ellen White says that gardening is the ABC of true education. God wants us to understand that it was through this blessed process that we were not just simply to know how to benefit us physically, but God wanted to benefit us spiritually. That's the gospel of health. And therefore, this is the system that God gave, not just to sustain the body physically, but to sustain the body of Christ when we understand the spiritual applications of the teaching. And so it is, brothers and sisters, that we are told. Now, when you look at that, that's a picture of gluttony. That's a picture of gluttony. I don't know about you, but I would call that overeating. What would you say? If somebody eats that in one setting, they probably would not be with us much longer. Now, when a person is gluttonous, when a person is consistently overeating and doing these things, eventually it becomes a part of their life. And do you know that the Bible shows that when we eat food, we are supposed to eat to live, not live to eat. Now, when an individual lives to eat, or the great way that you can know that is that whenever the belly growls and we just surrender to it and give it whatever we want without taking into regard what God has said on how to govern the human machinery, that means that we are controlled by appetite. And when an individual is controlled by appetite, the Bible says, put a knife to thy throat if thou be a man given to appetite. You understand that? I want you to see how much God hates when we are controlled by our appetite. The reason why is because God knows that it's going to put us in a position where eventually we'll deny him and say, who is the Lord? That's what the point Solomon was saying. Solomon was trying to bring across to yours and my mind that when we begin to eat and drink to the point that we just do what we want, when we want, how we want, eating to the full, and all these other things with no regard for God and his counsel, it is as if we are given to appetite, and God says it would be better to be dead than to let appetite control us. Brothers and sisters, it was on the point of appetite that Satan worked through Eve and brought sin into the world. The reason we have sin, sickness, death, disease, and poverty today was because somebody could not control their appetite. That's a solemn thought, brothers and sisters. And that's why Jesus had to get victory on the very place where Adam and Eve failed. Adam and Eve failed on appetite. And when Jesus came in, what was the first temptation Satan brought to Jesus? Appetite. Jesus had to get victory where Adam and Eve failed so he can be a perfect example to you and I of the importance of temperance. And so it is that the Bible makes it clear, put a knife to thy throat if thou be a man given to appetite. God doesn't want you and I to live to eat. He wants us to eat to live. It's a biblical principle. with eternal ramifications. And so it is that we learn flesh food also is harmful. Its naturally stimulating effect should be a sufficient argument against its use. And the almost universally diseased condition of animals makes it doubly objectionable. It tends to irritate the nerves and to excite the passions, thus giving the balance of power to the lower propensities. This is what happens when we begin to indulge in things not properly. Now, brothers and sisters, I want to make something very clear right now. I am not saying that under every circumstance that eating flesh food is a sin. Listen carefully to my words. I am not saying that under every circumstance that eating flesh food is a sin. But I do want to show you when eating flesh food is a sin. Go to the book of Genesis chapter 9. When is eating flesh food a sin? Notice I said flesh food. I didn't say pork, and I didn't say shrimp, and I didn't say crab. I'm talking right now about the cow. I'm talking right now about the goat. I'm talking right now about the chicken and the turkey, and I'm talking right now even about the fish. When can eating fish, chicken, turkey, goat, and cow, and all these other things, when can that be a sin? People say, wait a minute, it could be a sin to do that? I thought that eating clean animals was all right. Well, let's let the Bible tell us. Go to the book of Genesis chapter 9. I want to educate you on this because too many people are practicing things that they don't truly understand. And as a result of this, we're hurting ourselves. Go to the book of Genesis chapter 9. I want to show you this. I'm showing you this to deliver you. You might think I'm presenting bondage, but I'm presenting freedom. Notice what the Bible says in Genesis, the 9th chapter. Noah is now delivered out of the ark. And now God is presenting the dietary regimen unto Noah. And notice what the Bible says in Genesis 9 verses 3 and 4. The Bible says, every moving thing that liveth shall be meat or food for you. Even as the green herb have I given you all things. But flesh with the what? Life thereof, which is the what? Blood thereof. What does the Bible say? Shall ye not eat? So according to the word of God, God's commandment, did God allow man to eat clean animals? What was the condition? No blood and what else? No fat. No blood, no fat. How do we know no fat? Leviticus chapter 3 and verse 17. These were the two things that God says he wanted to be removed out of the animal if you're going to eat it. All the blood needs to be extracted, all the fat needs to be taken out. Now, this is before there was ever a Jewish man that walked on earth. This is not a Jewish law. How do we know that? Because this is Noah. Noah was not a Jew. The first Jew was Abraham. And Abraham wasn't even born yet. You understand that? All right. So this is God's counsel to Gentiles before there was ever a Jew. Now, let's speak even more plain on this. Now go to the book of 1 Samuel 14. 1 Samuel, the 14th chapter. Now look here. In 1 Samuel, the 14th chapter now, let's notice what the Bible says here. In 1 Samuel chapter 14, now let's take another look at another biblical account. Here, King Saul made the children of Israel fight against the Philistines. And he made them fast while they're doing it. Now, brothers and sisters, you don't go into a physical battle with anybody when you're fasting. Because the natural physiological effect is that you're going to be weak. You're not going to have a lot of strength. But notice what the Bible says in 1 Samuel chapter 14, and we're now going to look at verse 29. The Bible says in 1 Samuel 14, verse 29, then said Jonathan, my father hath troubled the land. See, I pray you, how mine eyes have been enlightened, because I tasted a little of this honey. It says, how much more, if happily the people had eaten freely today of the spoil of their enemies which they found, for had there not been now a much greater slaughter among the Philistines? Jonathan is literally telling his father, Dad, if you didn't make the children of Israel fast, they would have had an even greater slaughter against the enemies, the Philistines. Now look at verse 31. And they smote the Philistines that day from Michmash to Ajalon, and the people were very faint. Verse 32, and the people flew upon the spoil and took sheep and oxen and calves and slew them on the ground, and the people did eat them with the blood. You see, Jews had a practice. In fact, it wasn't just Jews. Anyone who was eating the meat of animals, they had a practice. It's called kosherization, which was a practice of how to extract the blood from the animal, and then they would extract the fat, then they'd prepare the animal and eat it. It was understood by Noah. It was understood by the children of Israel. But the people here were so hungry that as soon as they got on the animals, they just started to kill the animals and immediately prepared them and ate them without extracting the blood. They ate it with the blood. Notice what the Bible says now in verse 33. Then they told Saul, saying, "Behold, the people do what? Sin against the Lord." The question is, what did they do? It says the people sin against the Lord in that they eat with the blood. And he said, "Ye have transgressed, roll a great stone unto me this day." So according to the Bible, what is sin thus far? When you eat the animal where the blood is still in the animal. The blood was supposed to be extracted. The blood was supposed to be taken out. The instruction was given to Noah. The instruction was given to Israel. And watch this. The instruction was given to the new believing Gentile Christians. Go to Acts, the 15th chapter. We're looking at Genesis before any Jews. We looked at 1 Samuel when there are Jews. And now we're going to look in Acts where we are after the probation closing on Israel. And now God's people are represented by the Gentile Christians. Now notice what the Bible says in the book of Acts, the 15th chapter. And when you get there, please let me know by saying amen. All right, we're in Acts 15. Now in Acts 15, you will find that what happens here, I love to give the backdrop. I think it's very good when we study the Bible to understand the backdrop. The Judaizers were a bunch of Jewish people who believed in Jesus, but they were still following a bunch of the laws that God gave to Moses. Circumcision, observing certain feast days, and the list goes on. And these arguments are in the book of Romans. These arguments are in the book of 1 Corinthians. The Judaizers were always going to the new believing Gentiles and telling them, "Congratulations that you accepted Jesus, you got to be circumcised. Congratulations that you accepted Jesus, you have to follow the feast days. Congratulations that you accepted Jesus, but you have to do these things too." So there was always a contention going on between the new believing Christians and then these Jewish converts. This created such an issue of what the Jewish converts were telling the new believing Christians that it had to be brought to the council in Acts 15. In Acts the 15th chapter now, I want you to see what the Bible says as we now look at verse 19. Here's the sentence from the council to settle the minds of the new believing Gentiles. Notice what the Bible says. It says, "Wherefore, my sentence is that we trouble not them which from among the Gentiles are turned to God." Now notice what specifically is mentioned that they are not to trouble the new believing Gentiles with. It says in verse 20, "But that we write unto them that they abstain from pollutions of idols and from fornication and from things strangled and from blood." It was taught in the days of Noah. It was taught during the days of Israel. It was taught in the Christian church era that God's people are not to eat or consume anything that has blood in it. When you and I eat the chicken, the beef, the fish, the turkey, the goat, and the list goes on, and when the blood is still flowing throughout that meat, according to the word of God, it is not just a dangerous thing. It's not just a bad habit. According to the Bible, it is a sin. Why? Because brothers and sisters, you heard Brother Rizzo say it earlier today in 3 John verse 2. What's God's desire for you and I? "Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health." Now listen. If you want nutrients, do you know where nutrients flow through? Blood. But do you know what also flows through blood? Disease. And when you and I eat animals with the blood, if the animal has disease in it, then we get the disease through the bloodline. This is the reason why the statistics are showing so incredibly clearly when individuals are on the flesh diet, they get all of the Western diseases from type 2 diabetes all the way down to hypertension, heart disease, cancer, and the list goes on. But when an individual begins to get on a plant-based, a whole food plant-based diet, they find that they don't get a lot of these diseases that is affecting Western society all throughout our planet. It was logical why God says, I don't want you to eat the blood. It was logical for God to say, I don't want you to eat the fat. Because God says, I own your body. You see, go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Let me show you something. You see, I thought about this one day. I said to myself, this is interesting. You know, Ellen White says that to violate the laws of health is to violate the law of God. She says this in Counsels on Diets and Foods, repeatedly throughout the book. So I'm thinking to myself, how could that be? And one day God showed me, 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Let me show you something. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, right there, verse 19, that beautiful text letting us know that we are the temple of God. I wonder if we ever considered the verse. You see, did you know that you and I cannot just eat whatever we want? God never made us to do that. Notice what the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19. The Bible says, what? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost? And then it says, which is in you, which ye have of God. What does the close of the sentence say? And ye are not your own. Now, why are we not our own? Next verse. Because we've been bought. You see, once an individual says, I accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of my life, that means that the blood that he spilled, that's that price that's spoken of in verse 20, for you are bought with a price. It's the precious blood of Jesus. When that blood of Christ is applied to you and I, and we accept him as Lord and Savior, what has happened is he just bought you. Now, brothers and sisters, when something is bought, who owns it? The item that's been bought or the person that bought it? It's the person that bought it. So God is saying, you're not your own anymore. I own you. And was it talking about your mind in the verse? No, it was talking about what? Your body. That's why it says, therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit. God says, I own the whole you. Now, when we understand God's ownership, brothers and sisters, correct me if I'm wrong. Even if you say, you know, I like Brother Lemon, let's assume you like me. And let's say you say, you know, I like Brother Lemon. I want him to come to my house. I would like to give him dinner or something. And let's say I come to your house and let's say I see something in your house that I like and I want to bring it home to my children so that they can enjoy it. If I take something from your house with the intention to go home and give it to my children and I never asked you permission, as much as I may be an evangelist and a teacher and everything else, what else am I after I commit that act? I'm a thief. I stole. Is that right? And you're going to let me know that. You're going to say, Brother Lemon, you're a nice guy and everything, but you just stole from my house. Now, brothers and sisters, if you and I can understand, but what if I said, well, I know I stole from your house, but I just wanted to give it to my children because they don't have what you have. In other words, I had a good intention. Does that excuse my act? No, it doesn't excuse my act. So it is, saints of God. We are to understand that your body's been bought. And when your body is bought, did you know you can't feed it or dress it or do anything that you want to do with it without first getting permission and instruction from the owner? So when I eat things that God tells me, don't do that, then do you know what I am if I go ahead and put it inside of my system anyhow, irregardless of what God says? I'm a thief. And that means I violated the eighth commandment, thou shalt not steal. And when you break the commandments, the Bible calls that sin. That's how you can violate the laws of health and violate the law of God. Do you see that, saints? And this is why God wants us to take it up a notch. He wants us to understand and take this thing seriously and to realize there's more at stake than just simply having a bad kidney. There's more at stake than just simply having a bad heart. If we let appetite control us, Brothers and sisters, it can affect our salvation, and we can lose our salvation. And this is what God wanted to bring across to our minds. So I want to make it clear. It is not that eating animal products is a sin, blanket statement. I can't say that, and no man can say that based on inspiration. But I can say based on inspiration that if we are eating animals, if we are eating meat, and if the blood has not been extracted from it, if the fat has not been extracted from it, then according to the Bible, that's a sin. And brothers and sisters, sin will separate us from God. So there does come a point in line where we need to understand the dangers of flesh food. We need to understand the dangers of flesh food. And we need to see that there is a point in time that the consumption of animals can become something that can affect our salvation, and not just your heart, not just your liver, not just your kidney, and not just the various cells in your system, and the list goes on. It's deeper than that. You understand what I'm saying thus far? If you understand what the preacher's saying, let me hear you say amen. Amen. Now watch this. We're also told, having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. Gluttony is the prevailing sin of this age. Inspiration calls gluttony a sin. It says, lustful appetite makes slaves of men and women and beclouds their intellects and stupefies their moral sensibilities to such a degree that the sacred elevated truths of God's word are not appreciated. The lower propensities have ruled men and women. Now, somebody may say, okay, but Brother Lemon, that's overeating animal products. But when it comes to plant-based, I could just eat as much as I want. Oh, yeah? You think so? Brothers and sisters, this same principle applies even if you're eating tofu. This principle still applies. God expects us to be temperate in our eating and drinking, even if it's wholesome. Notice the words of the prophet. It is possible to eat immoderately, even of wholesome food. It does not follow that because one has discarded the use of hurtful articles of diet, he can eat just as much as he pleases. It says overeating, no matter what the quality of the food, clogs the living machine and thus hinders it in its work. So we must understand that just because we go plant-based doesn't mean that we can just go all out. At all times, God expects us to be completely temperate. You eat until you're satisfied, not until you're full. Now, what really is the danger of this? Now, like I told you, science is late, but I still appreciate science. Notice this. When we think of medical science today, there was an article, March 28th, 2010. Look at this article here. A new study published online, March 28th, in Nature Neuroscience. Listen to this. It describes that these rats, let me give you the backdrop. What they did was they wanted to understand this issue with overeating. So they began to study rats. And what they did was they allowed the rats to overeat. And they found that when the rats would overeat, it triggered chemical changes in their brain. Watch this. It says, Nature Neuroscience describes these rats' indulgent tribulations, adding to research literature on how excess food intake can trigger changes in the brain. Now, this is science finding this out. Like I told you, Solomon already knew that. Proverbs 30. Ezekiel already knew that. Ezekiel 16. So God knew that. This is the gospel of health. This is why every time when we teach health principles, we want to point the people back to the Creator. We want to help the people see the one who is wiser than mankind. Because I'm going to say this with all due respect. When we teach health reform based on scientific evidence, brothers and sisters, I'm going to speak to your intelligence. Let me ask you something. If we teach health reform just based on scientific evidence, for every scientific evidence that we put out to let people know why we should eat and drink and live a certain way, correct me if I'm wrong, is there not scientific evidence to counter it? Yes or no? You tell people plant-based diet, there's somebody who says, well, we did our research and we found that eating this or drinking milk and so on and so forth. And then what happens is we get into all this scientific battling back and forth, back and forth. But if we can help people understand the Creator, you see, this is our final contribution to this earth. Seventh-day Adventists, I'm telling you right now, we're late. Many of us have missed our grandest opportunities. Right now, the New Agers have won the world hook, line, and sinker. And what's happening is more people are following. You see that? And that's what I'm fearful of. If we quote too much and point too much to all the various scientists and so on, you know what the people are going to do? They're going to lean on the wisdom of the scientists. But when we begin to point them, that's what's been happening this week. When we point the people back to the Creator and we help them see, this is what God says. This is the one who owns your body. This is the one who made us. This is what He says. The more that we do that, then people begin to get drawn to the Creator rather than the creation. So here it is, that overeating, it causes changes in the brain. Now, one of the things that it causes in the brain is something called dopamine disorders. Now, watch this. Dopamine, what's the function of dopamine? Look at what it says. Cognition and frontal cortex. In the frontal lobes, dopamine controls the flow of information from other areas of the brain. Dopamine disorders in this region of the brain can cause a decline in neurocognitive functions, especially memory, attention, and problem solving. That's why whenever somebody overeats, they fall asleep. This is why. If you and I overeat and then you come to a meeting like this and you go ahead and you're trying to stay awake and all these other things, you find that there's a battle going on in your mind. Your belly needs blood so it can digest your food. Your brain needs blood so it can focus. That's why one of the great things that I hate, I can't stand teaching right after potluck. I hate it. Because 9 times out of 10, God's people aren't paying attention. Because their brains are foggy. They can't understand. They're not able to pay attention. Did you see that? That's one of them right there. Attention. Especially if we're overeating. Memory. Many people say, oh, how do you get these memories? How could you memorize so much Bible, spirit of prophecy, and all these other things? Brothers and sisters, it's not magic. It's following God's plan. If you follow God's plan, if you do what God says, and if you ask God for the gift, He'll give it to you. Psalm 119 and verse 11, David says, I have hid thy word in my heart. The word heart in the Hebrew means mind. I've hid thy word in my mind that I might not sin against thee. Brothers and sisters, memorization of scripture is not for the purpose of wowing people. Memorization of scripture is designed to be a defense in your mind when temptation comes to you, and that God's word is hid in your mind so that you will not sin against Him, because in your mind you know the way of escape. That's why it's your duty to memorize scripture. It's your duty. It's not a cool thing that you're supposed to look at other people and say, oh, look at how great they are. No, you're supposed to strive for it yourself. And God can do it. There's no mind too dull that God can't make brilliant. If we cooperate with His moral and physical laws, God can do anything with our minds. And He can help us retain information. Let's continue. You see, we need to understand that this is the bottom line. What's the bottom line of this issue of eating and drinking? You see, we must understand that erroneous eating and drinking results in erroneous thinking and acting. This is what God wanted us to understand all along. That erroneous eating and drinking results in erroneous thinking and acting. This is what God wanted us to see, because God wants us to have right actions, but He wants us to have a clear mind. But if we eat erroneously, it's going to affect our mind, which is going to affect our actions. So therefore, erroneous eating and drinking results in erroneous thinking and acting. And then watch this. After that, we're told, thus actions repeated form habits, habits form character, and by the character, our destiny for time and for eternity is decided. That's the point that God is trying to bring across to us. When we allow ourselves to be governed by appetite, it's going to affect our mind and put us in a place and in a condition where we will not be able to follow the counsels of God. Observe with me, saints. Watch this. This is why it is imperative to understand when the Bible says, whether therefore ye eat or drink, or whatsoever you do, what does the Bible say we should do? Do all to the glory of God. You see, in other words, right now, I've been showing you the problem. The problem is, many of us are eating erroneously. Many of us are eating in the wrong manners. Many of us are not practicing health reform, diet reform. And as a result of that, we are in a condition in our minds that we are not able to faithfully follow what God has called us to do. God wants to change that. So how does he do it? He says, I want you to understand, whether therefore you eat or drink or whatsoever you do, do all to the glory of God. This ties in perfectly with the first angel's message. What's the first angel's message? Fear God and give glory to him. Well, how do I do it? God says one of the ways you do it is by how you eat and drink. So do you understand that that's a commandment? That's not a suggestion. That's not a good counsel. That's a command from God. Whether therefore you eat or whether therefore you drink or whatsoever you do, do all to the glory of God. And the question is, how in the world do I do that? How do I do that? How do I take this theory and make it practical? Well, here's how you do it. Watch this. What we have to do is find out what is the glory of God. You see, once you understand what the glory of God is, then you can know how to eat and drink to it. Does that make sense? So watch this. So what is the glory of God? Well, in Exodus 33 and verse 18, Moses comes to God and Moses says, Lord, I beseech thee, do what? Show me thy glory. So what does Moses want to see? He wants to see God's glory. Now watch how God responds to him in verse 19. In verse 19, God says, I will make all my goodness pass before thee, and I will proclaim the name of the Lord before thee, and will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and will show mercy on whom I will show mercy. So God is literally having a dialogue with Moses. Moses says, Lord, show me your glory. God says, no problem. I'll show you my goodness and proclaim my name. So the first lesson we learn is that the goodness of God, the name of God, and the glory of God are the same thing. They're talking about the same thing. That's like me going up to my brother and I say, do me a favor, please show me your car. And he says, no problem, I'll show you my Toyota. I said car, he said Toyota, but are we talking about the same thing? Yes, we're talking about the same thing. We're just using different terms. They're talking about the same thing. Moses says, Lord, show me your glory. God says, all right, I'll show you my goodness and proclaim my name. They use different terms, but they're talking about what? Same thing. Did God show Moses his glory? Yes. Where did he do it? Exodus 34. Now watch this. God now shows him his glory. Exodus 34, 5 through 7. Let's take a look at the glory of God. Notice what inspiration says. And the Lord descended in the cloud and stood with him there and proclaimed the name of the Lord. And the Lord passed by before him and proclaimed the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering, and abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, and that will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children and upon the children's children unto the third and fourth generation. What did God show Moses? He showed him his character. So therefore, the glory of God, the goodness of God, the name of God is God's character. So therefore the Bible says, whatsoever you eat, whatsoever you drink, and whatsoever you do, it must reproduce my character in you. Whatever you eat and whatever you drink, it should reproduce the attributes of God's character in you. That's how you eat and drink to the glory of God. So therefore the question is, what are some of the attributes of God's character? Since the glory of God is his character, how do we eat and drink to it? Observe. Let's take a look at this. Now, I want you to watch this. I want you to write these verses down, but I'm going to go through them quickly. So for those of you who want to take notes, you write them down, but I'm going to go through them very quickly. In Deuteronomy 30, verses 19 and 20, the Bible says, I have set before you life and death, blessings and cursings. And then God says, choose life. That's in verse 19. In verse 20, God says, I am your life. In John 14, 6, Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. In John 11 and verse 25, the Bible says, I am the resurrection and the life. So what is the attribute of God's character that we're studying right now? Life. So whatever you eat and whatever you drink, it should reproduce what? Life in you, not death. Whatever you eat, you have to say, will this reproduce life in me, or is it going to reproduce death in me? If you can intelligently know, this thing is going to kill me. This thing is going to begin to break down my blood cells. This thing is going to get ready to debilitate my system. This thing is going to go ahead and open up my system to receive all sorts of sickness and disease and bacteria and viruses. Then you know right there, I don't need to eat that. But if you know that when I eat this, I know this is going to produce life in me. That's why all this week, you've been studying about things that put life in you. God says, that's what I want. When you read Psalms 46 and verse 1, the Bible says, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in the time of trouble. So God is what? Strength. Yes? So therefore, whatever you eat, it should do what to your body? Strengthen your body, not do what? Weaken your body. You understand that? God says, I am not the author of confusion, but of peace. 1 Corinthians 14:33. So whatever puts my body in a state of confusion, I should not eat that. But whatever can keep my body in a state of peace, I should eat that. This is when you'll start understanding why God said so strongly. Do you know the Seventh-day Adventist position? Many years ago, I don't understand, in certain places it has changed. Do you know that in the baptismal vows, there was a time that we would literally tell the newly baptized converts, we would tell them not only to abstain from unclean animals, but we would tell them to abstain from coffee and tea. Did you know that that used to be a position of the Seventh-day Adventist Church? That was literally part of the baptismal vows. Why? It was because of the components in the coffee and the tea, primarily the caffeine and all those other things. These components would stimulate the system, and it would do such damage to the body and debilitate the mind that it would hinder us from properly understanding God's will or doing God's work, and it would weaken and debilitate the very system that Jesus bought with his precious blood. So did you know that it was actually a standard in our church many a times? I don't know, do you do that out here in the Philippines? Do you bring these things up in your baptismal vows here? You do, look at that. See, you're more faithful than many in America. Seriously, you're more faithful than many in America. Many in America, they wipe that thing out. But that's the whole reason. I want you to understand the rationale-wise. It was not that we just were haters of coffee and haters of tea and all these other things. And I'm not talking about the herbal teas. We're talking about the more so the black and white teas and so on. I'm not talking about those. We're talking about these things were actually debilitating the system. They were contrary to the will and plan of God. And this is why the Lord says, I want my people to reform on this. I don't want them to eat these things because it's going to debilitate them. Now let's go on. I'll go past this one here. Did you know that when you look at the generations of those who lived before the consumption of flesh food and those who lived afterwards, look at the differences. Before eating flesh, Adam lived to 930, Seth 912, Enos 905, Canaan 910, Mahalalel 895, Jared 962, Enoch 365, and that's only because he never died. Methuselah 969, Lamech 777, and Noah 950. They were living almost up to a millennium. Once God allowed man to eat flesh, notice what happened. Shem 600, Arphaxad 438, Selah 433, Eber 484, Peleg 239, Reu 239, Seru 230, Nahor 148, Terah 205, Abraham 175. You literally saw the lifespan dropping once mankind started to consume flesh. And this was flesh without blood, this was flesh without fat, this was flesh without contaminations, and it still was draining the lifespan of mankind. Somebody says, well then why did God allow man to eat flesh? Write this down. Councils on Diets and Foods, page 373, paragraph 3. The servant of the Lord says the reason why God allowed man to eat flesh was to shorten his lifespan. We think that God gave man flesh because there was nothing else for him to give him. Brothers and sisters, think about it. If God ran out of food supply, the flood wiped out all the plant kingdom, yes? Yeah, it did that. But saints, think about it with me. Just think with me. How long did it take God to create plants before? How long did it take God to create plants before? One day. If it only took God one day to create the plant kingdom before, then it wasn't a problem for God to just simply say, mangoes, rise, and mangoes just could have popped up. God could have said, mangosteen, rise. I had some mangosteen today. Absolutely delicious. God could have said, banana tree, rise. God could have said, broccoli, lettuce. He could have said, everything, rise, and it would have rose up immediately. So God didn't have a problem where he was like, uh-oh, there's no food. I don't know what to do. God had a plan. God says, I am not going to allow man to live up to 900 years old anymore and practice evil. God says, I'm going to put a check on sin. And God says, one of the ways that I'm going to do it is I'm going to allow man to consume flesh to shorten their lifespan. That's the reason why God gave flesh. It wasn't because he wanted to bless us. It wasn't because he wanted us to just be happy eating animals. It was because he says, I'm going to put a check on the widespread corruption of sin. I want you to think about it. There's a man by the name of Saddam Hussein. Has any of you ever heard of him? Did he do great wickedness in this world? Do you know that he did his great wickedness in less than 80 years? What if he could live to 800 with the technology we have today? What would happen to our world if Adolf Hitler, what would happen if Adolf Hitler could have lived to 900 years old practicing the wickedness that he practiced in less than 80 years? This world would literally disintegrate, brothers and sisters. God knew what he was doing. God said, I have to put a check on sin. And therefore, God allowed the lifespan to become much shorter. And the way that it happened was he said, I'm going to put man on a flesh diet. That was actually why. So I want you to understand that. So the next time you say, well, why did God give man flesh to eat? I'm giving you the answer. That's the reason why, to shorten their lifespan. It was not to make them happy. It was to shorten their lifespan. Now watch this. Understanding physiology. We're told, without health, no one can as distinctly understand or as completely fulfill his obligations to himself, to his fellow beings, or to his creator. Therefore, the health should be as faithfully guarded as the character. Oh, that's a sentence that's loaded with counsel. It says, a knowledge of physiology and hygiene should be the basis of all educational effort. A knowledge of physiology and hygiene. We were supposed to understand these things. Now, why do I say that? Because did you know that God gave us instruction in the Bible? He gave us instruction on times to eat. The Bible says in Ecclesiastes 3 and verse 1, the Bible says there's a time for everything under the sun. Is eating and drinking something we do under the sun? Yes, it is. So then there must be a time for it. Is that right? Because there's a time for everything under the sun. So therefore, you and I, when we understand physiology, we will begin to understand the proper times to eat. Now, you and I know, brothers and sisters, that our bodies are not supposed to be digesting while we're resting. And that's why your meal needs to be finished and fully digested before your bedtime. So I heard today that our recommendation was 10 o'clock. If you're going to go to bed at 10 o'clock every night, you need to be finished eating your meal at no later than 5 o'clock. If you're having a full meal with the complex carbohydrate, with the plant-based proteins, and with the minerals and vitamins. If you're having a full meal, I'm not talking about a fruit meal, that digests quicker. But I'm talking about if you're having a plant-based diet, that you're having a full meal, it's going to take a minimum of 5 hours to digest. So if you're going to go to bed at 10 o'clock, you need to be finished eating at no later than 5 o'clock. You understand that? It takes a minimum of 5 hours for a full meal to be digested. You understand that? You look so fearful. Don't be afraid, sis. Ladies and gentlemen, let me tell you something. My wife and I have 4 little children. Well, they used to be little. But even when they were little, right now, their age is 15, 14, 13, 12. My son is basically my height now. We have put them on this program and diet. 2 meals a day. Their last meal of the day is typically 3 o'clock, 3:30 in the afternoon. Last meal of the day. That's it. They don't eat after that. And people think that my children would look like a bunch of little skeletal dying kids. Oh, I wish you could see my children. My children could probably outrun even Brother Rizzo. I mean, just loaded with energy. I'm serious. My wife will tell you, our children will wear us out. My daughter Jada always comes to me, Daddy, can you chase me? And I got to really think about the answer, because once I say yes, I got to fulfill my obligation, because I can't disappoint my little girl. And here when she, Daddy, can you chase me? I'm like, all right. And when I start chasing that girl, I mean, I am amazed at how that little girl, my children remind me of how out of shape I really am. But you know what's amazing? Two meals a day. Their last meal of the day, 3 o'clock, 3:30. And they're fine. They get there, if they get checked up at the doctor, everything, perfect bill of health, perfect. They don't look skeletal, they don't look pale, their eyes are not popping out of their sockets. They look like happy, healthy children. Now, brothers and sisters, I'm on the same program they're on. They just got a little bit more energy than me. Sometimes I'm not as fully obedient as they are. They rebuke me. But brothers and sisters, I don't think I look skeletal and sickly, do I? No, I don't think so. I don't look skeletal. I don't look sickly. What I'm telling you is that God, when he gives us his program, it works if we follow it. There's a time to eat. There's a time to drink. You drink 2 hours after your meal because it takes approximately 2 hours for the food to get out of your stomach and go into your small intestine. So therefore, you take 2 hours after your meal, and that's when you drink your liquids, and you should only drink water. Because as taught, water doesn't require any digestion because there's no calories in it. So therefore, 2 hours after the meal is when you drink. None of this stuff where you're eating food and then you got a cup of water right there and then you're sipping. When you do that, you're violating the laws of health. You're violating the laws of health when you do that. You're not supposed to drink anything with your meal or immediately after your meal. 30 minutes before, 2 hours after. Do you know? I mean, literally, it's a Bible principle. Temperance and moderation. Oh, can we do this? Let's see. All right, I promised myself that I was going to stop in about 7 minutes. So we're going to stop in 7 minutes. Wherever I'm at, I'm going to stop in 7 minutes. Watch this. Proverbs 24. Go there very quickly with me. Proverbs 24. Let's talk about moderation. I want to talk about moderation from a biblical perspective. Proverbs 24. The Bible says in Proverbs, the 24th chapter, notice what the Bible says. Proverbs 24, verse 13. And let's notice what the Bible says. Biblical moderation. Now, brothers and sisters, the Bible is so simple. Biblical moderation. Sometimes we know things are bad, but we say, oh, I'm just going to eat it in moderation. Saints of God. We got to do better than that. The Bible gives us principles on eating in moderation, but notice the biblical moderation. Proverbs 24 and verse 13. The Bible says, my son, eat thou honey. Why? Because it is good. And the honeycomb, which is sweet to thy taste. So notice this. The Bible, first of all, is it all right to eat honey? Yes, because the Bible says it's what? It's good. So watch this. Now, of course, there's proper ways to prepare honey, and then there's bad ways to do it. So the Bible, of course, is talking about the best ways to do it. But is it okay to eat honey? Yes, because the Bible says it's what? Good. Now, watch this. If the Bible says it's good, you can eat it. If the Bible says it's good, then you can eat it. But watch this now. Watch this now. Proverbs 25, 16. What does the Bible say in Proverbs 25, 16? It says, hast thou found honey? Eat so much as is sufficient for thee, lest thou be filled therewith and vomit it. That's powerful biblical moderation. Biblical moderation says, only eat it if it's good, but only eat sufficient amounts of it. Don't overindulge. Even in something good. It's okay to eat certain food groups that are good, but if you eat too much of it, it can have an adverse effect on you. Wheat is a great example of that. Wheat is great for us. Wheat is good for us, but wheat is also mucus forming. So if you and I are doing wheat in the morning, wheat in the afternoon, wheat in the evening, and then we do it 7 days a week, then what's going to happen is you're going to start building up a lot of mucus in your system, and before you know it, you're going to find yourself, especially if you suffer with allergies. Do you have allergies here in the Philippines? Do you have that? In the U.S., they have allergies and all these things. You find your human machinery, your system starts getting clogged with all that mucus buildup. So God says, even when it's good, only eat sufficient amounts. Don't go soy crazy. Soy is good, but soy is not meant to be eaten at breakfast, lunch, and dinner 7 days a week. Most of us are on what's called the dog food diet. You know what a dog food diet is? Eating the same thing every day. That's a dog food diet. The dog doesn't wake up one morning and say, I like puppy chow, and tomorrow I'll have kibbles and bits. That's not what a dog does. A dog says, I'm eating the same thing every day, the same old stale food right here. And that's what the dog eats every day. Many of us, we're on a dog food diet. We're just eating the same thing every day. Some days you're going to do almond milk. Some days do soy milk. The next time do cashew milk. Work with it, saints. Diversify. One day wheat, the next minute rye. The next time couscous, quinoa. Do different things. Switch it up. Your body likes the diversity. You've been hearing about that all week. So these are the things that God says, I'm trying to give it to you so that it's designed to help you. Ecclesiastes 10:17, eat for strength. Eat for strength. Whatever you eat, saints, whatever you drink, saints, make sure it's strengthening your body. Make sure it's ministering to your body. Why? Because we got to wrap it up. Because we need to understand this. Oh, if you get this, you got it. Food gets broken down to blood. That blood feeds the health of our brain. Our brain is where we get our thoughts. Our thoughts is where we get our actions. Our actions repeated is how we form habits. Our habits is what forms our character. Our character is what determines our destiny. When you understand this, you will understand the connection between diet and destiny. Food that we eat gets broken down to blood. That blood has to feed our brain. Our brain houses our minds where we have our thoughts. Our thoughts is where we get our actions. Our actions repeated is how we develop habits. Our habits is what forms our character. Our character determines our destiny. This is what God wanted you to understand. This is what God wanted me to understand. This is what God wanted Israel to understand. And so it is, saints. Why does God take eating and drinking so seriously? Really, why does he do it? You see, the beginning of our week, we talked about that Sunday law crisis. The Sunday what crisis? Sunday law crisis. Why is eating and drinking so important? The reason why, saints, is because Satan is getting ready to launch the greatest trial to make sure you and I will not succeed in being faithful to God and his law. God has given us the greatest gift of heaven, which is Jesus. And when he gave us that gift of heaven through Jesus, he gave us Christ so that way we can have power to keep his law and to honor him in all things. But have you ever wondered how we serve the law? The Bible says, we serve the law of God with our minds. That's how we keep the law. We serve the law of God with our minds. God gives us power. He gives us ability. He gives us strength. He gives us everything we need, but it is through the exercise of the will, through the mind, that we keep the law of God. And brothers and sisters, if you and I are eating and drinking in a way that debilitates the mind, we will not be able to faithfully serve God's law. And that's why the Lord says, I want you that whatever you eat and whatever you drink and whatever you do, do all to my glory. Because at the end of the day, saints, don't ever forget, and the very God of peace sanctify you wholly. And I pray, God, your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. God takes your body seriously. God takes your mind seriously. God takes his work seriously. And brothers and sisters, health reform was given as a gift to Israel. God knew that when he gave them the manna, it was the best food adapted for them to fulfill their mission. Do you know the children of Israel lived off of manna for 40 years? How is it that such a source of food could bring sustenance to them? You can keep playing, we're closing. How is it that such a source of food can sustain them for 40 years? Brothers and sisters, God is saying to you and I tonight, he's saying, listen, this is not legalism. There's no plant, there's no bread, there's no fruit, there's nothing that can make you righteous. Health reform cannot make people righteous. Health reform is an evidence of the righteousness we have received by faith. If you believe in Jesus, if you trust Jesus, and if you believe God's word, you're going to obey his word. And if God tells us through the Bible and the spirit of prophecy, get off of the flesh pots of Egypt. If God through the Bible and the spirit of prophecy says, I want you to start practicing more control in your eating and drinking habits. If God says through the Bible and spirit of prophecy that I want you to learn how to eat and drink to my glory, it would be foolish to disregard what God says. If you love him, you're going to do what he says. And so I present none of this information to try to say, this makes you righteous, this makes you holy. Eve ate the healthiest fruit to ever touch this earth, and it brought sin into the world. So there's no article of food that can make you right. But what it is that our eating and our drinking habits testifies if the one who is right lives in me. And when we're controlled by appetite, saints, we are not reflecting the character of Jesus, because Jesus, when he was in that wilderness, Jesus was emaciated. He was down to almost skin and bones. Jesus was hungry, saints, because he didn't eat for 40 days and 40 nights. And Satan didn't come to Jesus with pork. He didn't come to Jesus with shrimp. He didn't come to Jesus even with beef or chicken. He came to Jesus with one of the most permissible foods to eat, and that was bread. Satan said, listen, just turn the stone into bread. What's so wrong with bread? But Jesus knew, I have to control my appetite. I must finish my fast because I am seeking and preparing to be an example for my people. And so Jesus exemplified the greatest control over appetite, even on things that were permitted to be eaten. And if we think that we can let appetite control us, and we can just indulge and eat because we just want to eat it, and yet think that that attitude is still going to allow me to get to heaven anyhow, saints of God, that's a deception. God came to open the eyes of the blind that they may see. We must practice greater temperance. And you know what's so good? The last I checked, the Bible says the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, and temperance. And so, saints, it's not by might. It's not by power, but it's by God's Spirit that you can say no to the things that are wrong and say yes to the things that are right. I share the story of my children with you as a testimony. I share the story with you of my own life. Brother Rizzo has been sharing with you the stories of his own life. Did you see that man? How many men look like that on a plant-based diet? Do you see how fit he is? There's no punishment in getting off of meat, saints. There's no punishment of it. It's just blessings. God is trying to say, I'm trying to bless you. I'm trying to spare you from the pain and hurt and all the things that comes when individuals indulge in appetite. God says, that's all I'm trying to do. I just want to bless you. And I want you to be a blessing to other people. And so the first work of reform with Israel was on the point of appetite. And I'm letting you know, if you're really going to keep the sayings that have taken place this week, you and I are going to need to get a better control of our appetites. And this can be done, not by might, not by power, but praise God, by His Spirit, saith the Lord. And so if it's your desire to say, I am going to cooperate with God's principles of health, we studied a lot. We studied a lot tonight. If you are willing to say, based on the truths of God's word revealed, I am going to seek to live in harmony with these truths, with these principles of health, so that by the grace of God, I could be temperate like how Jesus was temperate. And then perhaps, not even perhaps, it will, you'll be in the same place with Jesus as well. And that's His desire for you. And so tonight, if you are making the decision in your heart, you're saying, you know what, I used to eat a certain way, or there's certain things that I do, and I am willing to comply with God's plan and live my life in harmony with His principles of health. You're going to need some cooking classes. You're going to need to know how to make those changes. That's why I'm telling you, that outpost center, those city missions, desperately needed. There needs to be a place that people can come to often and receive the instructions like these, and then see it demonstrated in practical cooking demonstrations. And the list goes on. All this week, saints, I've been eating plant-based food from some of the precious sisters here who've been coming up and singing, and they have fed my wife and I wonderfully with food that promotes health according to God's word. So I'm very happy. There's people right here in this sanctuary tonight that they know how to do this. You need to get with them. You need to talk with them and say, please teach me, show me. Show me how I can make the transition. And they'll show you by the grace of God. You'll learn it and you'll be able to do it. And only blessings will come your way. So if it's your decision tonight to say, yes, I am willing to comply with God's principles of health according to His leading, would you please stand with me? You're making that decision tonight. You're saying, that's it. I'm going to do what God says. You're standing to your feet. Nothing but blessings is what the Lord wants to give you. And so as you stand, know that Jesus stands with you. Know that He's on your side. He'll be your source of strength. He will give you His Spirit, and you will have power to do His will. Amen? Amen. Let's close and let's seal it with a word of prayer as we go before the Lord. Father in heaven, we thank You for the things that You've shared with us tonight. Thank You for helping us to see that first work of reform. And Lord, as You did that great work with Israel of old, I pray that You'll do that great work with Israel today. Help us, Father, and seal us in the decisions we have made tonight. And may we experience all the blessings that You have promised to give to all those who learn what it is to no longer live to eat, but by Your grace, eat to live. And I thank You that You've heard this prayer. Bless my brothers and my sisters as they cooperate with heaven, is our prayer we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.